Hey, good evening. I'm Colm Colgan, and you're very welcome to the Business and Enterprise Show, Ireland's only live web-based TV business program. Tonight's guest is one of the county's largest electrical retailers, Paul Hayes of Hale Expert. You're very welcome to the program.
Thanks very much, Colm.
Before we start off about Hayes Electric and Hayes Expert, we might find out a little bit about Paul Hayes first.
All right. Paul Hayes is a good young man. Been working in Cavan now for the last 25 years and live at home, live in Coot Hill, have done, married, have four children, and that's basically me.
The commute from Coot Hill to Cavan every day isn't too much of a problem?
Not too bad, no, you get used to it. My wife works in Cavan, has done so for all her work in life, so it's been a natural enough experience. No problem.
So anyway, the name of the business is Hayes Expert,
yes,
but they're two separate entities. This is Hayes Electrical, but you are part of the Expert Group.
Yes.
You're not owned by Expert. In fact, you probably are a part owner of Expert. Could you explain that? Obviously better than I could.
Okay. Well, the actual name of our company is Hayes Television Centre Limited. We were founded in 1960, and then we've had a couple of different changes of trading names as we have moved through the generations. So we would have been known as Hayes TV Rentals for short, rather than Hayes TV Centre Limited. And then after TV Rentals, we became TV and Video. And then
Video,
TV,
I remember that.
Yeah, in the old days. And then Hayes Electronics. And Hayes Electrical is one that has definitely stuck. People still refer to us a lot as Hayes Electrical. But in the last 5 years, our trading name has been Hayes Expert. And the reason we're Hayes Expert is we are very much a part of the Expert Group, which is 52 independent retailers who have come together in almost a co-op like format to develop their business and to support each other. And but we are all independent, and each of the franchisees or owners looks after their own patch. Basically.
And if I went to an export, your own Expert store in Cavan, and I went into another Expert store in Dublin, would it look very similar from the layout, or is it more individual than that?
Well, no, there is very much an element of mass marketing and merchandising. When we started out as Expert in Ireland, we weren't 100% sure of what the colour scheme should be and what the logo should be, and we were experimenting. Expert Europe came down heavy upon us, and we were doing the wrong thing as a group. So we got our act together, and we have an image that is universal throughout Europe, and now it's in fact throughout the world. So when you walk into an Expert shop in Ireland, it's pretty much the same as walking into one in Switzerland, Belgium, America, Brazil. It doesn't matter. The logo is the same. There are strict guidelines on how it can be used, how it must appear, and the colour schemes of the scale are the same. We're very much orange and black and white, and everything in any Expert shop throughout the country is basically geared towards the same.
So I always thought Expert was an Irish operation. I wasn't aware that it was worldwide.
No, Expert is mainly European. There are over 3,000 shops in the Expert family. In actual fact, the president of Expert International is a Cavan man, Kieran O'Reilly, for living out in Mullaghorn, originally from Arva. He is the chairman of Expert International. It's mainly European. It's very, very strong in Scandinavia, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, but it goes right throughout Europe. Expert as an organisation is, I think, the second biggest in the world in terms of its purchasing power, in terms of its sales out to the end user as electrical retailers. So we are part of that. We have access to the best products throughout the world, and basically with the right deals. So when Kieran O'Reilly talks to Samsung at a board meeting in Switzerland, that filters back to us in Cavan.
Now, Kieran, as the chairman, is he somebody who went away and worked his way up the ladder? Is it a rotating chairman? Or?
Yeah, well, probably they have to be elected. But Kieran is still the CEO, the chief executive officer of Expert Ireland. that's his day-to-day business. He attends board meetings and he oversees the running of Expert International. His main function, and as far as I'm concerned, and the vast majority, all the members of Expert Ireland, is that he runs our show. We have a central office based in Mullingar. That's Kieran's base, and he spends his days dealing with our suppliers, organising them so that they can benefit us.
You can benefit your customers.
And that I can benefit my customers.
Expert, was that originally known as Natalex, or did Natalex die and then it was replaced by Expert?
Well,
I think Natalex, that was purely an Irish operation, wasn't it? Yeah.
Basically,
and I am going back 20 years now.
You're skipping a bit there, but basically, where Expert came from, it was always a European organisation, and an Irish group of retailers got together and decided that they saw the writing coming down the wall, that on the wall, that there was going to be competition coming in from the UK, that the UK multiples were going to be coming to Ireland, and that they'd better get their act together and bandy together and buy right and organise themselves. So a group got together and organised a company called Natalex, National Electronics, and Natalex for short. And they were able to do some deals, but the vast majority of the Irish trade didn't want to talk to Natalex because it was seen as basically before its time, and it hadn't got any buying power and it hadn't got any strength. But as time progressed, within the group, a change of management basically decided to join Expert and align itself to a European organisation, and Expert was the one that it chose. There were others such as Euronix and other organisations that could have joined, but it joined Expert. And as a result of joining Expert, Kieran O'Reilly was approached to become the new chief executive, and when he came on board, the group got far more serious, and more bigger retailers throughout the country joined it. And when they started to join it, the suppliers said, "Oh, well, we better deal with these people." And so when the first big organisations started to say, "Yes, well, we'll do a deal with you, we'll supply you, and we'll look after you as a group," then it took off.
Now, do you have to apply, and is there a vetting procedure to become an Expert franchisee?
Yeah, very much so. it's difficult to become one. It's expensive. I won't go into the details on that, but it is. And you have to be prepared to run. You have to have a certain population and size of the market. And yes, there's very, very strict criteria to get involved with Expert,
Now, when we started off, you mentioned the different trading names you've had, which reflected the various operations and what was popular at the time. You might start at the beginning. I suppose in the 1960s, when it was set up as Hayes Television, televisions were relatively new.
Yeah, my dad came back from England he was a television engineer, technician, or repairman. The want of a better word, he trained in England, and he decided to set up in Ireland. He was Irish, and he came back. He opened up a shop in Coot Hill in 1960, and he started selling televisions. There weren't many about, and the reason mainly he chose Coot Hill as his starting point, believe it or not, was that the television reception was very, very good. There was a great UTV signal, and Coronation Street was big at the time, and people.
And of course, RTE hadn't even started. Hadn't started.
But it was based on the UK signal, so he opened up, and he competed immediately. Funny enough, in Coot Hill with one of the bigger players in Ireland at the time, they were called Bernie's, and he tackled them head on, and. His main, as time developed and people wanted televisions, you must remember back in the 1960s, a television was the third most expensive thing that a person could buy, their house, their car, and then the television. So not every home could afford a television. So television rental became a new product, and he expanded into television rental, and it became a very, very big business for him. And then basically we follow television rental to its extremity until it more or less died, although it's not completely dead. There's still a niche market for it.
And in the early 60s, what was Coot Hill like? Was it a, you know, a lot of the shops, unfortunately, in Coot Hill are kind of boarded up anytime I'm up there. What was it like in the 60s? Was it a bustling town? Was there industries around? Because again, I remember when I went to school, we used to learn, one of the things you did in geography was you learned the industries of a town. And a town would have it in. And if I'm not mistaken, Coot Hill had a footwear.
Yeah, it had factories, small factories. It had a factory called Cloth Manufacturers, which manufactured, as it says, cloth for export, and it was a fairly big employer in the town. That would have been set up in or around the late 50s, early 60s. It was a market town. There was a fair day in Coot Hill, and it was very much a traditional market town that served Belfast in the going back, you know, pre the 60s, the 40s, the 50s, the 30s. It would have seen itself as, you know, the big market town in the south of Ulster. The 50s wouldn't have been kind to Coot Hill. It was a quiet area.
I don't think the 50s was kind anywhere in Ireland.
It was bad, but the town had begun to recover in the 60s, and then in the 70s the Chamber of Commerce was very active, and it brought in big industry. It brought in Abbott Ireland, and as a result of Abbott Ireland coming in, other factories opened up. There was a rubber factory making rubber hoses, and it came in and it provided good employment. And there's a lot of small industry around Coot Hill at the moment.
Sure. How big is Abbott? How many? I'm sorry when I say how big. How many people would work there?
I don't know exactly.
Are you talking hundreds?
In the hundreds. Yes.
Would it be that big? Yeah.
Yes, in the hundreds.
So that would be a big thing to hold off. So the factories were coming in. People were obviously buying the paper, reading about, as you say, Coronation Street and things on the television. You know, so they were beating the path to your father's shop, or was it a hard sell?
He actively went out and looked for business, as we still do. He marketed his business. He employed salespeople. He went our market from Coot Hill, which is on the Cavan Monaghan border, stretched to Glengevlin, and down to North Monaghan, and down to Scotstown, and everywhere in between. We went, as you know, you're from living in Ballyburn, and we went way beyond Ballyburn. We went down to Kilmaine and Wood to Worker. Basically, all of Cavan and Monaghan and the fringe areas around each of those places.
And of course, rather than just saying, again, going back to your father's day, it wasn't a case of, would you be interested in buying a television? It was a case, this is a television. This is what it does. You literally had to demonstrate.
Not really. People became very aware of it very quickly. And, you know, obviously they'd come to the shop and get a demonstration. You know, we didn't have to go in and physically demonstrate it in their houses. But over a period of time, the industry developed. And then every home had a television. And then it expanded to having, you know, two of them. We can follow the progress of televisions from push-button black and white to colour, then colour to remote control, and remote control to teletext to flat screen big back to flat screen normal, and so on, to where it is today. So there's been a lot of changes that have kept us going. It doesn't stand still.
Well, we'll find a little bit more about the television industry, and indeed the early and latter days of Hayes Electrical, Hayes lots of other things, but now Hayes Expert, after this short ad break.